RoxAnne Tauriello Show takes you inside prison and jails as men reveal lives of sin and consequences. Hear God's amazing message of hope. Listen to the testimony of the infamous David Berkowitz and celebrities like Jerome Hines and Melba Moore, to athletes Marvis Frazier and Charles Way, to Dr. D. James Kennedy and Joe Douglas. The RoxAnne Tauriello Show, where you'll find out how to receive from God forgiveness, a brand new life, and eternal life. Greetings, I'm RoxAnne Tauriello, and we're here at the Williamsburg Music Theater in Virginia to interview Tom Netherton, whose presence, voice, and grace is part of making the Lawrence Welk Show one of the all-time favorites. We're going to take a break, and we'll be right back with Tom Netherton as he talks about his youth, the Lawrence Welk Show, and how fame, fortune, glitter, and glamour pale in comparison to the joy of knowing Jesus Christ as his own personal Savior. And we'll be right back.
The RoxAnne Tauriello Show takes you inside prison and jails as men reveal lives of sin and consequences. Hear God's amazing message of hope. Listen to the testimony of the infamous David Berkowitz and celebrities like Jerome Hines and Melba Moore, to athletes Marvis Frazier and Charles Way, to Dr. D. James Kennedy and Joe Douglas. The RoxAnne Tauriello Show, where you'll find out how to receive from God forgiveness, a brand new life, and eternal life.
And welcome back. And joining me is Tom Netherton. Tom, thank you so much for allowing us this interview.
Well, just thrilled to have you here right on the stage of my new show here in Williamsburg.
Yes, that's thank neat. You, Tom. Tom, you were born in Munich, Germany, to Lillian and Captain T.H. Netherton. How many brothers and sisters are in the family?
Well, I got one brother and two sisters, so there's four of us, and we're all about 3 years apart.
Mm-hmm. And very beautiful mom, too.
Oh, she's gorgeous. Yeah, she's wonderful. And my dad's just a great guy. And, just love them both.
Yes, praise the Lord. Now, at 9 months old, you have an encounter with the press?
Yes. I know. I'm in the front page of all the newspapers across the country because we were the first returning occupation troops, you know, uh-huh. coming back. And I was 9 months old. My mother held me up in the portal of the
yes.
ship that we were on, and a photographer took that, and that was on the paper. But it
throughout
was syndicated.
Throughout the country.
Yeah, throughout the country.
9 months old.
9 months old, yeah. So it was my first. Robert Taylor was on one side, and some other, I don't know what the headline was, on another, and then my mom and I were in the
yes.
center.
Now, in high school, you make a dare with someone. Tell us what happens.
Well, actually, we came in, some friends of mine and I came in to heckle some of our friends who mm-hmm. were trying out for the high school musical.
Right.
And then a friend of mine got this bright idea to dare me to go down and sing.
Mm-hmm.
And I knew he didn't sing. So I said, sure, I'll go down and sing if you go down and sing.
Mm-hmm.
He went down and sang. And I couldn't believe it. And everyone heard the dare. And then
it's your turn.
I had, oh my gosh. What do I do now? So they started chanting, we want Tom, we want Tom.
Mm-hmm.
So I had to go down and sing, and I sang the song, and I knew the melody to it, but I didn't know the lyrics. So I just stood at the piano, and I just sang it. And then I looked up, and I saw this girl who liked me a lot, and she was crying. And I thought, oh my gosh, I've even embarrassed her so much. This is awful.
And she's weeping, and you say
weeping.
To yourself,
yeah,
she must be crying because
yeah,
she
so
feels
bad.
Sorry for you.
Right, it was so bad.
Now you finish the song.
Right.
People are cheering. They're yelling. They're applauding. They're going bananas. What does Tom Netherton think?
Yes, well, that's what I was getting to, guys. I just thought it was, they were just putting me on. You know, I was so embarrassed. I wasn't
yep.
going to come back to school the next day. It was
you
a junior
out?
High school. But I came back the next yeah. day, and then a bunch of friends met me at the bus, and they said, have you seen what's happened?
Mm-hmm.
And then they came in, I said, no. I said, check the bulletin board. So I came in, and I had the lead in the musical, and then I went, oh, my gosh.
Now, you weren't the type of the person that walked around singing at home, or were you singing in the shower?
No.
Was your family aware of your talent?
No, I never sang at all. I wasn't in choir or anything. I didn't do anything like that. So this is all brand new. And then I was in track. My friends and I were in track. We came in after track practice. So I told the directors, I said, you know, I got track. I can't do this. And they said, look, we've already talked to your track coach. You can do both. And then they talked me into trying it for a week. Mm-hmm. And then after that week, well, sometime during that week, the show business bug kind of bit.
Talk about hidden talent.
Yeah, it kind of hit.
Now, Tom, when you speak on stage or television, you sound wonderful. I mean, the words flow. I mean, you sound like you were a natural from childhood. Was that always the case?
No. And then as I've gotten older, too, my voice has gotten lower on top of it. But, of course, you had to do your speeches and whatnot in school, but mine were always prepared. I had little arrows going up, you know, like raise your voice mm-hmm. up here and bring it down here and keep it flat here. And so it's kind of all choreographed out.
You say in your book that when you were in speech one, you felt like it was a death sentence when you had to get up and speak.
Oh, yeah. It was just awful.
And you also stated in your book, after doing that, there was one thing I was certain. I would never be a public person.
A public person. Never could get up, never could get up. And, no, just, and now here I am, you know, 30 years later sometime.
Oh, praise the Lord.
It's amazing what God's got in store for us. We don't know.
Yes. Now you joined the service.
Yeah, I enlisted in the Army.
To go to Vietnam?
I thought for sure.
But instead, your orders are to spend 2 years in Panama, and like everything else, you put your heart into it. And on your off-duty times, you sing, you do some TV, you have a great car, headquarters job, and you stated in the book, Foster Grant sunglasses, and you said you felt like a pretty groovy dude, and life was just a bowl of mangoes. Yet, in your book, you say this, Tom. You state, except there was still this strange feeling inside me that I was in Panama for some important purpose, and I knew I hadn't found it yet. I went snorkeling, skin diving, you mentioned, dancing at the Hilton, partying on the beaches with the cream of Panamanian society. But there was a longing, a deep longing, going far beyond the tropical nights and days. Nothing seemed to satisfy it. It had been there all my life. Tom, tell us about the day that God began to change you and your life.
Well, you know, it was really not just a day. In fact, every time I went to a different army post for my training, I met different Christians.
Yes.
And they talked to me about Christ. They didn't talk about being a Baptist or a Methodist or Presbyterian or whatever, you know, or Assembly of God, or they talked about Jesus. And then I thought, well, that's interesting. You know, I've heard about Christ, and I went to church growing up. But it wasn't until I went to church one night with a friend of mine to hear Major Ian Thomas speak. Wonderful evangelist, English evangelist, and I just loved his voice and his wonderful command of the language. And he just said one thing that God used as the key to unlock, you know, the understanding of my heart. And he said that Christians were what they were only because of Jesus Christ actually living in them and giving them the power to be the kind of people they couldn't be on their own. And so I sat there and God just spoke to me and says, you see, Tom, it's me and you giving you the ability to be the person that you want to be, but you can't on your own.
Right.